give God praise. God is worthy to be praised. He's worthy to be magnified. You can't clap your hands enough for the Lord. You can't praise him enough. Somebody said, if I had 10,000 tongues, I couldn't praise him enough. So we can't praise him enough. But every time we get an opportunity, we ought to give him praise. We ought to give him honor. We ought to give him glory. We ought to give him the fruit of our lips. We ought to give him the sacrifice of praise. By just telling him thank you. And you get up in the morning and you just tell him thank you. Glory to God. You give him the fruit of your lips. And we praise God. We bless him. And we bless you in the name of the Lord. The Lord is wonderful. And he's worthy to be praised. He's worthy to be magnified. Nobody can do us like the Lord can. Nobody. Whatever we need, God's got it.
All right. Amen.
Whatever we need, God already has it. Glory to God. You go to some people that are looking for it. They say, let me check on it. Let me see where I can get it from. But God's got it already. Right. Glory to God. Whatever you need, God's got it.
Hallelujah.
Just ask him. And believe in it by faith, and it shall be done in Jesus' name. Glory to God. Today we're going to the book of John, the 15th chapter of the book of John in your Bibles. We read from the King James Version. We're going to the book of John. We just praise God for everything that he's doing. He's the reason why we're alive today. Nobody did it but God. In the situation God has brought us out of. Some people never thought we'd come out of those situations, but God. And another thing to say about that situation. Praise the Lord. I'm glad that the Lord didn't turn us over to ourselves. That we're in his hands. Glory to God. We're in perfect hands. We're in the hands of the Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God. John the 15th chapter. I'm going to read the 12th through the 15th verse. You have it. Look on with me. Write it down. This is my commandment, that ye love one another as I have loved you. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Ye are my friends, if ye do whatsoever I command you. Henceforth I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth. But I have called you friends. All things that I have heard of my Father, I have made known unto you. The thought today is Jesus is our friend. Jesus is our friend. Jesus is our friend. It's amazing in life to talk about friendship. God has made us to have fellowship and kinship and relationship with each other here on earth. We are made to cohabitate together here on planet earth. From the extensions of our immediate family to the various individuals and people that we connect with in our lives and those connections that we made. And the truth of the matter, we all need friends in our lives. Though many people will claim to have many friends, or they think they have many friends, the truth of the matter is the statement is not true. If we can count five true friends on our hand, it's a miracle. Though the term is used loosely in our world, we got many associates, we got many extended relationships, but we have very few friends. Even in a time when we can display on the internet hundreds of friends, even on Facebook, people have hundreds and thousands and millions of friends and followers, but really those people are just acquaintances and people that just want to be connected with them. It said that everyone, and we ought to know that everyone doesn't love us, and that is true. And we're alike more than we different, all of us as human beings. We're more alike than different. But the enemy of mankind and our own selfish ways and ambitions, the sinful nature, causes us to not be friends and be the friends that God has called us to be in this world. You're blessed if you have one true friend. You got one true friend, you're blessed. A friend is someone you can trust. A friend is someone that loves you in spite of you. And they love you in spite of what they can get from you or take from you. They're not seeking to belittle you or control you. That friend will tell you the truth in love. A friend will be able to tell you you're wrong, you're not right. They'll be able to tell you, and they love you. They're not trying to expose your imperfections or your weaknesses to everyone. They will share with you when you succeed. They will share, and they will not glory in your failures. And they're not always trying to compete with you in this life. So when you have true friends, you love their company. And you love being around them. The person, even when you haven't seen your friend in 5 to 10 years, when you come back in connection with them, there's something that you just pick up where you left off. Because they're your true friend. Friends will be with you through thick and thin, through trouble, through adversity, through sickness, through heartache, through pain. A true friend will be with you. Webster's dictionary states it like this. It would say a friend is a person attached by another, by affection or esteem, a favorite companion, a person who knows and with whom one has a bond of mutual affection, exclusive of other ties. And in times like this, how many of us know we need a friend and we need a savior? Proverbs 17:17 says, a friend loveth at all time, and a brother is born for adversity. Proverbs 18:24 says, a man that has friends must what? Show himself friendly. If you want to have friends, you got to show yourself friendly. And a friend is there that sticketh closer than a brother. Proverbs 27:17 says, iron sharpeneth iron. So a man sharpeneth the countenance of his friend. And in Proverbs 12:26 in the NIV version, it says, the righteous choose their friends carefully, but the way of the wicked leads them astray. So we need good friends. Abraham is mentioned in the Bible as being a friend of God in the scripture 3 times. He was a friend of God. How? Reconciliation with God. He was a friend of God through saying yes to God, to being available to God. He was a friend of God by having hospitality to God and being obedient to God. 2 Chronicles 20:6-7 said, and said, O Lord God of our fathers, art not thou God in heaven, and rulest not thou over all the kingdoms of the heathen? And in thine hand is there not power and might, so that none is able to withstand thee? God is over the heavens and everyone. Art not thou our God, who didst drive out the inhabitants of this land before thy people Israel, and given into the seed of Abraham thy friend forever? Isaiah 41:8 says, but thou Israel art my servant Jacob, whom I have chosen, the seed of Abraham my friend. James was a friend of God. And Abraham was that friend. In the book of James, the 2nd chapter 23, it said the scripture was fulfilled, which said Abraham believed God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. So we can see then how that by works a man is justified and not by faith only. Also in the Bible, in the book of Exodus 33:11, the Bible said the Lord spake unto Moses face to face as one man speaketh unto his friend. And he turned again into the camp, but his servant Joshua the son of Nun, a young man, departed not out of the tabernacle. And even when you begin to go through the Bible, even in the book of Job, when Job was going through many tests and trials, and he was tempted, the Bible lets us know, and we read, that Job had 3 friends that turned against him. They didn't stick with him through thick and thin. They didn't support him. They didn't pray for him like they should. They added to his heartache. And that God, it caused God to speak up against his friends and said, who are these people that give dark counsel to you? They haven't even speak me. They're not hearing from me. They just say what they want to say. They give him judgment and dark counsel instead of being godly examples of friend to Job in the time of need. When we also continue to look in the Bible, you see David and Jonathan in the books of Samuel, 1 and 2 Samuel. They were friends who formed a covenant, the Bible says. In the books of Samuel, you can read, the Bible records in 1 Samuel 8 and 3 that Jonathan loved David as his own soul. This was not a sexual love, but it was a godly love. It was brotherly love. It was a Jesus love. It was a true friendship love. It was faithful and true relationship that God is calling for. Because you can't love others unless you love God and love yourself. And Jonathan esteemed himself. He esteemed others higher than himself. And he was willing to even give up his kingdom for David because he loved him as his own soul. What? How many people are that selfless today? Jesus, the Son of God, even when we look in the text and read through the Bible, Jesus is our true friend. He's our true friend. Jesus' name, meaning it was translated, God is salvation. Jesus, who we're talking about today being our friend, is the Son of the living God. He is the epitome of true friendship from God. He has love for his fellow man, his fellow brother, his fellow sister. Jesus is the Savior of the world. He exemplifies the human relationship between two individuals, even when he was on earth. Jesus, who is second person in the Trinity, when you read your Bible. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. God in three persons, blessed Trinity. God manifested as the Son of Man. God wrapped in himself, delivered himself to us on earth through the Immaculate Conception. And Jesus was there all the time. The Bible records, even in creation, the Bible records and said, let us make man in our image, in our likeness. Who do you think God is talking to? He's talking to the Son and the Holy Ghost. Jesus, the Blessed Redeemer, the light of the world. Jesus is our true friend. Jesus, the Bible lets us know, is a friend to the friendless. And he's hope for the hopeless. He's joy for the joyless. Jesus was the fulfillment of the law and the prophets. Jesus is the wisest person to ever live. Jesus is the greatest teacher. He's the greatest preacher. He's the great deliverer. The Bible lets us know in the New Testament, he's the great testator. Yeah. Jesus is the greatest gift from God. Jesus is our great master. And Jesus was so meek and mild. He had humility and meekness. He was humble. And he's known as the Prince of Peace. Jesus was the calmer of every storm. Yeah. Jesus was the Word that was made flesh and dwelt among us. Jesus is the dispensation of grace from God, who brought us truth and the life. And Jesus was manifested to destroy the works of the devil. Now Jesus was the perfect sacrifice. He sacrificed his life for all mankind. And what a friend we have in Jesus. Yes. Jesus was obedient even unto the Father. Jesus is the friend that we need. The Bible says in Philippians 2, 5 through 11, it says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of man. And being found in the fashion of man, he humbled himself, and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore the Bible said, God has highly exalted him, and given him a name above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of the things in heaven, the things in earth, and the things under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father God. Who would want a friend like this? A friend that's got all power. Jesus is the friend that will be with you when you go through the fire. See, a friend, a true friend, will be with you when they scandalize your name, when they do all kind of manner of things to you. A friend won't dump you. They won't throw you away like some insurance companies do when you have three accidents. Just throw you away. Jesus will be with you through the fires and the storms of life because he's a true friend. Jesus will be with you through your challenges, through your adversities, through your situations that you must go through. He will stay right there with you. You can count real friends on your hand. He will always be with you. And then Jesus will deliver us from our afflictions and our distresses. What are you talking about, Brother Pastor? When you read the Bible, you even look at the book of Hebrews, where the three Hebrew boys were going through the storm in their life. The Bible said Hananiah, Azariah, and Mishael, that's their real names, Jesus was with them when they had to be put in the physical fire. The fire, the Bible said they came out, they weren't burnt, they didn't smell like smoke, neither was their hair singed, nothing was wrong with them, and they didn't look like what they had been through. Who would want a friend like Jesus? That when you go through the storm and the rains of this life, you always got somebody you can depend on. Even when you're at home by yourself, Jesus, the song said, Jesus, he never left us alone. He's always there, always there. The Bible said that Jesus is touched by our infirmities. He's touched by our weaknesses. And he knows what's going on in our life. Yeah, we get on the phone and we can call people and they can, sometimes they empathize with us, sometimes they can sympathize, but Jesus knows exactly what's going on with you. Because everything that you go through are different from everybody. You feel differently when you're going through things. Yeah, you may be going through a death, but I may have felt different than you felt at that time. But Jesus knows exactly how I feel. That's the friend I need that knows exactly what I'm going through. A friend that can encourage me and bring me through. Jesus, he empathizes, he sympathizes with us. He knows our infirmities, he knows our weaknesses. And the Bible says, through God, he gives us new compassion daily. Great is thy faithfulness toward us, O God. Jesus is our great intercessor. You can't call on nobody that can intercess for you to God like Jesus can. Jesus is always intercessing to God because we've made many mistakes. We've made many errors. And every day we're confessing and asking God to help us. And Jesus is petitioning the Father, Lord, give him another chance. Lord, be merciful unto them. I need a friend, and Jesus is a friend indeed. He's reading our calls daily. He's the great advocate. I know there's some great lawyers, but can't nobody advocate like Jesus. Glory to God. And the Bible says he's a very present help in the time of trouble. Who has a friend that can have all these many different components in him than Jesus? Jesus is everything that we need. Jesus is the answer to every prayer. Jesus is the answer for the world today. Whatever you're going through, whatever you're in, Jesus is the answer. I need a friend like Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. When you begin to look in the Bible, in the book of the disciple John, which we looked at today, the beloved John records in his gospel the words of Jesus the Christ. John was in the inner circle of Jesus' disciples. And Christ records, it's recorded what Christ says starting in John, the chapter 15. There's a discourse. There's a course where Jesus is saying the effects of being connected with him. If you're going to be connected, whoever you're connected with has influence over you. So you ought to be connected to Jesus. Jesus said himself, he said, I am the vine, and you ought to be connected with me because you are the branches. He said, God is the farmer. God, he's the one who prunes and takes care of the garden. But the people, you got to be connected to me. If you're not connected to me, you will not survive. Jesus is the only one you can be connected to that can take you all the way through. He said, the branches cannot survive without being connected to who? Jesus. He said, I'm the vine. The vine is the source of life. The vine is the substance. The vine is the resource. And if the branches don't stay connected to the vine, they will die. They're going to wither. If you ever cut grass, we know that when the branches fall off the tree, they're no good for nothing to be but burned in the fire. That's what the Bible says. He said they're only good to be cast in the fire when you read through the text. He said, anyone that you, when you cut, you know that they're only good to throw them in the fire when you're not connected to the vine because you lose your source of life and there's no connection for you to be effective on the tree. And because of this connection, the obedience, we have direct access to God to be fruitful. We have access to ask whatever we will of the Father. What kind of friend is this that you can ask the Heavenly Father who's sovereign, that's in control of the whole world? If you got Jesus as your friend, you can ask what. will do it in his name. Glory to God. God said, Jesus said, shall be done if you ask of the Father. Jesus is the answer to every prayer. And all things in prayer are in the name of Jesus, because God is glorified and the devil is glorified. Yeah. Jesus states that the Father loves him. And because the Father loves him, Jesus, I love all of you.
Yeah.
And we should all continue in love. Love covers a multitude of faults. Love covers a multitude of sins. A true friend ought to love you. They ought to love you no matter what. And Jesus said, I love you, because love lifted us. Love created us. Love saved us. Love heals us. Love delivered us. And so if we keep the commands of Jesus Christ, if we obey the voice of God, if we know obedience is better than sacrifice, because the sacrifice of Jesus and the obedience of Jesus, we have love and humility of Jesus that will abide in us. And we can ask the Father whatever we will. Jesus says that I pray that your joy would remain in this world. That you would have, that your joy would be fulfilled. That's the kind of friend you need that's looking out for the best for you.
Amen.
That's praying for the best for you.
Yes.
Want you to succeed. Because the joy of the Lord is our strength. He wants us to keep our joy. He wants us to keep our strength. He wants us to keep our salvation. He wants us to keep our faith and our hope. And the commandment was that all we do is we love him. We ought to love him because he what? He first loved us. And we must love one another as Jesus has loved us. And love is stronger than hate. And when you look at 1 Corinthians 13, it tells us that Paul records the attributes of love. Jesus is the friend of ours. He's the Savior of the world. And he loves us because love endures. Love is patient. Love is kind and thoughtful. When you look at your friends, love isn't jealous. If you got some jealous friends, they would have got your friend. Love isn't envious. Love doesn't brag on itself. Love isn't proud. Love isn't arrogant. Love isn't rude. Love isn't self-seeking. Love isn't easily provoked. Love isn't easily angered, but it doesn't keep record of much of wrong. Love rejoices, doesn't rejoice in injustice. It rejoices in justice. It rejoices in the truth. Love bears all. Love believes all. Love hopes all. And love never fails. We need love in our world. We need love. Jesus gives us love as a true friend. And our relationships need love. Jesus is a love song. Jesus is God's perfect gift to us. He's the perfect example of love to mankind. Let me repeat that to you again. You write it down. Jesus is God's perfect example of love to mankind. That unconditional agape love that Jesus was willing to lay down his life for you and I. Deuteronomy 31 and 18 said, the Lord, he is that doth go before thee. He will be with thee. He will not fail thee, neither forsake thee. Fear not, neither be dismayed. John 3:16 lets us know that God so loved the world that he did what? He gave his only begotten Son. That whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. And the Son gave his life for creation, all mankind. So when we look at the Bible and read in John, so the Son of Man, Jesus says, greater love had no man than this. What has he done? He said, then I lay down my life for my friends. How many friends do you have that are willing to lay down their life for you? Jesus, I lay down my life for you because you are my friends. And then whatever I command you, if you do whatsoever I command you to do, you're my friends. He said, henceforth I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what the Lord doeth, but I have called you friends. For all things I heard of my Father, I have made known unto you. Jesus, I'm making known all the things. I'm making known the keys to the kingdom to you. Because you're my friends. And I want you to succeed. I want you to inherit eternal life. I'm making a way for you. So as we look at friendship, and we look at kinship, and we look at Jesus being the perfect friend of ours, in this time that we're living in a time of depression, in a time of isolation, in a time of oppression, in a time of a pandemic, in a time of pandemonium, in a time If you want to make it through these times, you got to have a friend like Jesus on your side. We got to have Jesus the Christ, the Messiah, the Anointed One, the only begotten Son on our side. The Bible said Jesus is the very present help in the time of trouble. And we're living in troubled times. And you need a very present help. And that help is Jesus. Jesus affords us the luxuries we have today. We're only here because of Jesus. Lord, we all could have died. We all could have died already from this pandemic. But God blessed us through Jesus that we're still here today. He said, no, not yet. Then we began to read and see the songwriter. Adam Jackson puts the song and pins the song and said, what a friend we have in Jesus. He said, all our sins and griefs to bear. Oh, what a privilege. We got a privilege. What a privilege to take everything to God in prayer. You can take everything. You know, sometimes you can't tell everybody everything. You can't let them know everything. But the Bible says, and we see even in this song, we can take everything to the Lord in prayer. And in the song, he said, oh, what a peace we often forfeit, and what needless pain we bear, all because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. It's time to take it all to God in prayer. Have we trials and temptation? Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged, but do what? Take it to the Lord in prayer. You got a friend in Jesus. Can we find a friend so faithful? Your friends, they may want to do everything for you, but they don't have the capacity, they don't have the power to do everything for you. But Jesus got all power from the Lord. He can do everything for you. Who will all your sorrows share? Jesus knows our every weakness. So we do what? We take it to the Lord in prayer. We need to do today, we need to do a self-examination today to really put our life under the microscope and see, really, are we really true friends to the people we call we friends to? Do we line up with what I talked about today? If we not, we need to pray and ask God to help us to be a true friend to the people that we call our friends. Are we really friends? Are we an undercover enemy of friendship? Are we an enemy of God when we're not friends? Are we fake friends? But you want to have true love in your heart. If you say you're a friend, you ought to be there for your friends. Jesus is a real friend. And Jesus is a friend of mine. And you ought to have him as a friend of yours today. And we have a friend in Jesus. The Bible says in Hebrews 13 and 8 that Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. I don't need friends that are chameleons. I don't need friends that have snake spirit sometimes. But Jesus is the same every day. We don't get out of the bed on the wrong side of the bed because he's Jesus all by himself. Oh, God, Jesus loves at all times. Jesus has a smile on his face. Jesus does put a smile on his face and stab you in the back. Jesus is the fake friend, and many are seeking people for friends in this world, but you really need Jesus. Jesus is the friend that wants to use you up and see what all they can get from you and then kill you. Jesus won't abuse you and throw you away. Jesus doesn't just run away at the tough time, but he's there all the time. Always waiting for you to cry out to him. And when we understand that Jesus won't turn his back on us. He's always there. And Jesus will carry us through. And the Bible said we can cast all our cares upon him, for he cared for us. And the Holy Ghost makes Jesus real to you and I. Jesus will help you. Jesus will deliver the truth to you. But Jesus is the truth and the life. Jesus will never forget what you've done for us. If he's our friend, we should never forget what your friend has done for you. You should never forget what Jesus has done for you and I. You should never forget how he died on the cross for you and I. How he was beaten for you and I. How he was bruised for you and I. How he was chastised for you and I. How he sacrificed his life for you and I. He bled for you and I. And he made a way for us. And let me know that Jesus, he didn't come down from the cross. Glory to God. Some people will be with you almost to the end. Then they'll leave you. in the name of Jesus. You got to understand that Jesus is our rock. He's our salvation. He's a pure rock. He's our fortress. He's our strong tower. And he's the only way that we're going to make it through these situations and these circumstances that are in our lives today. Yeah. Jesus is a wheel in the middle of the wheel. He's seen Joseph. You got to see Jesus walking through the hands of time. Yeah. God, through the power of God. Jesus is the rose of Sharon. Jesus is the lily of the valley. Jesus is the balm in Gilead. You ever need to be healed? Jesus is a healer. He's a way maker. He's a provider. Jesus is a rock in a weary land. We got weariness all around us. People are losing their mind. They want to commit suicide, but they need Jesus on the inside. Something on the inside. Oh, comes to the outside and bring about a change in our life. Jesus is the Lamb of God. Jesus is the Son of Man. Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus is our
God. I need Jesus in my life. I need him every day.
I'm crying out to Jesus every day. You need Jesus in your life today. Won't you receive Jesus into your life? You can receive him wherever you are at. There's no special place that you have to be to receive Jesus as your Savior. He will come into your life. Say, Lord Jesus, I'm a sinner. Forgive me of the wrong I've done, the wrong I've been. I believe that you are the Son of God. I believe that God raised you from the dead. Now, Lord Jesus, come into my life. Cleanse me of all unrighteousness. Cleanse me of all my sins. Come into my life. Be Lord of my life. Be Savior of my life. And I will serve you for the rest of my life. If you prayed that prayer, if you repeated those words, you're already saying, Jesus is in your life. He is your friend. You got the greatest friend of all mankind in your life. Someone needs healing today. There are sisters and brothers in the hospital. There's fathers and sons in the hospital. There's mothers and daughters in the hospital. Somebody's sick and shut in. Somebody's desolate and distressed. Somebody's isolated. And we pray today that God will heal you from the inside out. Glory to God. Nobody even knows you're sick. But we pray right now that God will heal you from the inside out, from the outside in, from the crown of your head to the sole of your feet. The presence of the Holy Spirit will be with you. Heal you from the inside out. And if you've done anything wrong, confess your sins. Confess your sins and go and sin no more. Let some worse thing come upon you. Sometimes we can't get healed because we want to stay in sin. But come out of sin. Confess your faults. Confess your whatever's holding you bondage. Confess it to the Lord. And give yourself to Jesus. Some and many in this world need the Holy Spirit. Glory to God. Hallelujah. The anointing is tangible. Glory to God. We pray right now. You ask God to fill you with the Holy Ghost. Glory to God. Fill and refill God with the Holy Ghost. In the name of Jesus. Men and women, boys and girls, be filled. Glory to God. Glory to God. Even if you're not filled when you watch this, you can be filled at any time. Glory to God. Because the Holy Ghost, hallelujah, is prevalent in this world. Glory to God. The Holy Ghost is everywhere. Glory to God. Jesus said, I don't go. Glory to God. The Holy Ghost is top of the basket. He said, oh, glory to God. He will not come. But thanks be to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Jesus had to walk on earth. But the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of God, they moved upon the face of the water. The Holy Ghost that formed the world. Glory to God. The Holy Ghost that wants to dwell inside of you. Glory to God. You need the Holy Ghost. Glory to God. I command the Holy Ghost to fill you. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Feel. Be filled. Obey the word of God. Glory to God. You've been seeking. You've been looking for the Holy Spirit. But you haven't quit. You haven't given up some things that are standing in your way. And if you've been praying and looking for the Holy Ghost and you're saved, you pray to God, say, God, I'm praying. What is it that's standing in the way? What is it that's hindering me from receiving the power of the Holy Ghost? Glory to God. Yes, get out. He can ask you all. He likes to know. Glory to God. He can see God. He can see God. He can know God. Glory to God. He won't dwell in an unclean vessel. He can't see the Matia. Glory to God. Hallelujah. To clean your heart. Glory to God. That's God to forgive you. Hallelujah. You got past hurts. You got some things sticking. You got jealousy. You got envy. You got hatred in your heart. He shut up on you. Glory to God. Get it out. Shabbat. See ya. Glory to God. God won't bless your mess. He won't. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Oh, the devil is a liar and a father of all lies. Glory to God. But I come to bring the truth. Glory to God. He shall not. Glory to God. The Holy Ghost is saving. It's filling with the Holy Ghost. It does the first work. It saves you. Then there's a second work. Glory to God. To fill you with the Holy Ghost. Glory to God. Hallelujah. People are being filled with the Holy Ghost. Glory to God. Be filled. You need the power of God in your life in order to stay safe. Hallelujah. Then you're turning their backs on the Lord because you need the power of the Holy Ghost in your life. Glory to God. Let it be prevalent. Get in a church that teaches the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, that teaches the whole Bible. Glory to God. Get under leadership that believes in the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Glory to God. And then stay in the Word of God. Once you get it, you got to stay in the Word of God. You got to praise Him. You got to worship Him. You got to fast and pray, because Paul says the flesh and the spirit, he writes that they war daily. And sometimes we can't do what we need to do because the flesh and the spirit are warring daily. So I got to fast and pray to keep my flesh, to keep that flesh, that mankind, under subjection. Glory to God. Because the flesh wants to get loose in everybody. The flesh wants to get people told. The flesh wants to be gratified. Glory to God. But you need the Holy Ghost. And when you start feeling yourself moving away, we all know our sins. We need to get more dedicated. We need to fast. We need to pray. So I'm getting too far out. I'm getting too reckless. I'm letting the flesh, I'm letting the man lead me, and let the Holy Spirit lead and guide us. Jesus, our friend, receive ye Jesus today. Come unto Him, all ye that have a laden, He will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you, learn of me. My yoke is easy, and my burdens are light. Mankind will throw all kind of burdens on you, all kind of things that you got to do to get saved. All kind of things you got to do that you, but you don't have to do all that. All you got to do is confess and believe and be filled with the Holy Ghost. The world needs the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Read about the Holy Spirit. Pray for the Holy Spirit. Pray that God will fill you again, refill you. And then once you get filled, you need to refill it. Refill me again. Touch me again. But Jesus is your friend. The Lord wants you to know that Jesus is your true friend. Many have been lying to you, telling you they're your friend. Many have been hurt, desecrated, in schools and churches everywhere because you thought someone was your friend. And really, they were just trying to expose your weaknesses and find out about you and talk about you. They're really not your friend. When you really get saved and we really get the Holy Spirit and really become what God would have us to be, really become like Jesus, we can confess our faults one to another. And we can pray for each other. I don't want to see my brother fall. I don't want to see my sister fall. I want to see them successful. Because the same God that blesses you will bless me. He's not a respecter of persons. So let us learn, all of us, get in the Word of God and see what a true friend is. And let us be friends to mankind. Let's not talk friendship. Let's be friends to one another. Friends don't hurt one another. They help one another. We praise God for you. Be blessed in Jesus' name. Clap your hands and give